Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Last year, we were here in Budget 2009 dealing with the results of the global economic recession. This year is all about building on the recovery that is underway in New Zealand. As a background to this budget, it's clear that the evidence for the need to rebalance and redirect this economy is overwhelming. Our export sector has been in recession for 5 years. Too much of our recent growth has been based on excessive consumption, fast growth in government spending, and significant borrowing by New Zealand, both government and households and businesses, to make up the difference. To the extent that our net external liabilities, that is what we owe to foreign lenders, was about 90 billion in 2000, stands at 170 billion today, and is forecast to rise to about 250 billion of total debt to foreign lenders by 2014. As a result of those imbalances, we have had since 2008 sluggish growth in this economy. Since 2005, we've had sluggish growth in this economy. In the 3 years up to the beginning of the global recession, growth in the New Zealand economy averaged less than 1%, and in fact, per capita GDP growth was negative. About half of our trading partner growth and about a third of the growth in Australia, our neighbour. The government faces similar challenges. The government's books were already going into deficit at the 2008 budget. The global recession certainly exacerbated that problem. So how will Budget 2010 achieve change in the economy? We have a number of objectives. We want to focus on higher and sustainable growth, and as we've said many times over recent months, to tilt the economy towards increasing its earning capacity, that is towards savings and exports and investment and new jobs. This budget includes a major tax reform package featuring across-the-board tax cuts that'll help families get ahead because of the lower tax rates and lower marginal tax rates, and keep more skilled Kiwis in New Zealand, particularly important objective given the pickup in the Australian economy. The budget also outlines an improved fiscal outlook over the next 4 or 5 years. Both Crown debt and government deficits are better than forecast in 2009. However, it is our aim to continue with the disciplines which will allow us to get back to budget surplus as fast as possible. And finally, the budget outlines the priorities for public spending, both the $1.1 billion of the new spending allocation and the $1.8 billion over 4 years, which has been redirected from less effective programs and low priorities to our high priority on frontline services in health and education. The budget also outlines, as part of progress in our public spending, the continued investment in substantial infrastructure projects in research, science and technology, roads, rail and ultra-fast broadband. All of these are focused on our overriding objective, which is to lift the performance of this economy as we move through this recovery. I now want to look at the budget forecasts. These are the forecasts, the red line of the forecasts from the 2009 budget, which clearly show a path to recovery. These are the new forecasts, The particular feature of these forecasts are that in the 2010-11 year, we're expecting 3.2% growth rather than the 1.8% that was forecast in the last budget. So we're looking at a faster exit from the recession, a stronger recovery with the stronger growth in employment and incomes that goes with that. In fact, these forecasts include forecasts of 170,000 new jobs over the next 4 years, and the early signs of that are the turnaround in the unemployment figures. And just as importantly, a lift in average real household incomes of around $7,000 over the forecast period. So more jobs and higher incomes occurring sooner. We now move on to the effect of this on the budget deficits. The yellow line is the track that we looked at in early 2009, that is the government deficits before the policy decisions of the 2009 budget. The red line shows the effect of the 2009 budget decisions, where the focus was to get some control over over deficits that were potentially spinning out of control. That showed that we would reach a surplus at around 2019. The forecasts for this budget are the white line. This shows us with a lower peak in the deficit at around 4% of GDP and returning to surplus 3 years sooner in 2016. I would point out that the deficit for 2010-11 is larger than that was forecast in the December update. 4.2% in this budget compared to 3.4% of GDP forecast back in December. There's a number of factors behind this. One is the cost of timing differences in the tax package, which has a cost of about a one-off cost of $460 million in its first year, and some one-off expenses which would have been incurred in the current financial year in health and treaty settlements, which will be incurred next year, the next financial year, as outlined in this budget. The medium-term track, however, is unambiguously better, and we are going to continue to work hard to get back to surplus sooner than forecast here. Now, the better deficits flow through into the better outlook for debt. The yellow line is, the line that we looked at in about March 2009, which showed ever-rising debt with no peak at any stage. The decisions in Budget 2009 were designed to bend that curve down. If we hadn't taken decisions of the type that we did, we could have found ourselves among those countries who this year have become a strong focus of sovereign debt markets. The forecast for this budget has government debt now peaking earlier and lower. It'll now peak at 27% of GDP in 2014-15 and falling to 14% of GDP by the end of the projection period. Our aim with the surge in public debt is to get it under control and then, of course, get it down so that New Zealand has the capacity to absorb any further economic shocks in the same way that it has been able to in 2008. And when you look at the volatility and uncertainty, particularly of global debt markets, it's quite possible that sometime in the next 10 years we could be subject to a significant economic shock. So these improvements reduce our vulnerability to these volatile sovereign debt markets. However, we are still vulnerable, particularly when we look at New Zealand's total external debt, and we must keep working to reduce that vulnerability to foreign lenders. I now want to move on to the principal spending decisions that have been made, just outline these in a general sense here with much more detail in your media packs. $2.1 billion for health over 4 years, $512 million this year. $1.4 billion for schools and early childhood education over 4 years. This will include a 4% increase to the school operations grants, one of the larger increases of recent years, a good example of moving funding from the back office bureaucracy into the frontline services. I just want to remark on early childhood education. As we pointed out in recent months, this has trebled from $400 million to $1.2 billion per year. Without any policy change, it would have required a further $200 million increase this year. We made some policy decisions that were constrained the increase in early childhood to $107 million extra. So early childhood will still be receiving proportionately the largest increase of any education service by quite a significant margin, but not quite as large an increase as was predicted. The Prime Minister's already announced the science and innovation spending. We have reprioritised $1.8 billion of spending within the public sector. I must compliment the public sector and my ministerial colleagues. Over the last 2 years, they've come up with just short of $4 billion of reprioritised spending within the whole public budget. That is moving services from less effective programs and back office spending to our higher priority frontline services. And of course, there's been a significant announcement of further significant infrastructure spending. In particular, the commitment of capital to rail, and I might also add the extra $1 billion package over 5 years to deal with leaky homes and unanticipated and significant expenditure. I now want to move on to the tax reform. It's vital that we see this tax reform as one of the principal methods by which we can rebalance this economy. There are not many levers you can pull in an economy that affect everybody's decisions, which is one reason why a lot of people, including the taxi drivers I ran into this morning, are keen to know what's in the budget, because it affects everybody. Our objectives are to produce a tax package to reward effort and help families get ahead, to attract and retain skilled people in New Zealand, to encourage savings and productive investment, and to make the tax system fairer. Here are the main changes in the tax system. Across the board, rate cuts from 1 October, the new rates are 10.5% down from 12% for the bottom threshold, up to $14,000, $14,000 to $48,000, 17.5% down from 21%, from $48,000 to $70,000, 30% down from 33%, and over $70,000, a reduction in the top tax rate from 38 to 33 cents. These changes will occur on the 1st of October, along with an increase in the rate of GST from 12.5% to 15%. There will be an immediate offsetting increases in welfare benefits, New Zealand Super, student allowances, and most working for families tax credits. And the size of that adjustment is just over 2% as estimated by Statistics New Zealand. From 2 o'clock today, any New Zealander can go to the website www.taxguide.govt.nz to calculate the impact on them of these changes. We've also made a number of changes to company tax, including a reduction in the company tax rate from the 2011-12 tax year, that is the next tax year for companies, from 30 to 28%. Alongside that, we're reducing the tax rate for most savings vehicles to 28% so that there is neutrality among savings vehicles. We're removing, as part of our policy of broad-based low-rate tax system, removing the 20% depreciation loading on new plant and equipment for assets purchased after today. By international standards, we have fairly high depreciation rates and higher than the true economic rate of depreciation. And in addition, again, because the information tells us that buildings generally do not depreciate, there will be no deductions allowed for depreciation on buildings with an estimated useful life of 50 years or more. In both cases, these changes bring the depreciation rates closer to economic reality, broaden our tax base, and allow us to have lower tax rates. Tax rules can change also for the 2011-2012 year to reduce the interest deductions that foreign multinationals can take by having high levels of debt allocated to their New Zealand subsidiaries. So this will happen by reducing the fin capitalisation threshold from 75% to 60%. This brings our treatment of the foreign owners of New Zealand businesses and assets into pretty much mainstream international thresholds for protecting our own tax base. We're also going to be tightening the rules around loss attributing qualifying companies and qualifying company rules, which will yield reasonably significant amount of revenue. The tax working group and the government have talked about closing tax loopholes to ensure that everyone pays the statutory tax rate and that people can't manipulate their circumstances in order to qualify for social assistance, which doesn't reflect their real economic position. From today, we will add back investment losses when calculating working for families entitlements, and we'll be issuing a discussion document about further tightening the rules on the definition of income for working for families and student allowances, with a view to implementing further changes by the 1st of April 2011. The changes in the tax rates have eliminated the advantage enjoyed by trusts. There's been very significant growth in the use of trusts. We believe that trusts have a role, but they should not be driven by tax considerations. These changes, including the preventing the GST Phoenix schemes, which is property related, and improved IRD enforcement, will ensure that those people who earn wages and salaries do not pay a higher rate of tax than people who are able to structure their business affairs for tax purposes. IRD have built up a clear track record in recent years where for every dollar of extra compliance effort that they make, they're yielding about $5 of revenue, and a significant amount of this has come from the property sector. We've decided to invest more in that compliance because we believe it will continue to yield around $5 for every $1 of effort. So the package will give Inland Revenue the resources to crack down on any more evasion and avoidance. We believe this does make the tax system fairer. Here are two aspects of the tax changes which we believe are important. First of all, two-thirds of the cost of the income tax cuts goes to reducing the bottom two rates. Two-thirds of the cost of the income tax cuts goes to reducing the bottom two rates. That is the rates that apply to people earning under $48,000. These tax changes will sharpen incentives across the whole economy, and this is often overlooked. 73% of income earners in New Zealand will now have a top statutory tax rate of 17.5% or less. So almost three quarters of New Zealand earners will face a top tax rate of 17.5% or less. That means for an extra hour of overtime, They only pay 17.5 cents in the dollar. For an extra dollar that they put into KiwiSaver, they are taxed only at 17.5 cents in the dollar. The government has been interested in reshaping the incentives across the whole economy, not just one or two groups of income earners. For those who are around the top of the $48,000 area, their marginal tax rate has in the last 2 years almost halved. If you're on $48,000 going out and working another hour of overtime just 2 years ago, you were paying 33 cents in the dollar. After the 1st of October, you will pay 17.5 cents in the dollar out of that extra hour of overtime. There are any number of ways that you can measure the equity of these tax changes, and this is an attempt to capture the impact of all these measures across three equally sized equally sized household earner groups. And what it shows is that all groups get roughly somewhere between 0.5% to 1% increase in their net incomes. So the impact of this tax package, taking into account all aspects of the tax package, not just the personal tax and GST effect, means that there's a roughly similar impact proportionately across all the income groups. It happens that low to middle income earners, particularly those with children, have been the biggest proportion of winners from tax changes over the past decade or so, including the tax changes announced today. There's a graph there which we'll show you if we can find it. I'll just move on to the impact on how, there it is there, look at that. The this graph shows us the benefits to low and middle income earners of tax packages actually going back to 1996. What it shows up on the left hand axis is the proportionate reduction in tax paid. So someone on $30,000 has had about a 48% reduction in the tax that they pay since we started making significant changes to the tax scale back in 1996 to 98, which was the last large-scale tax changes. These figures exclude working for families. So if you add in working for families, those percentages are much higher. Much higher. In fact, after these changes, a household with two children pays no net tax until they earn over $50,000. Up to $50,000, they are receiving family tax credits and in-work tax credits. At $50,000, the inflows meet the outflows, so they pay net zero tax for a family of two at $50,000. And it's only when they earn over $50,000 that they start paying tax, net tax, to the government. We believe that that is an impressive achievement for families and for New Zealand. And actually, this graph shows that the tax system has become proportionately more progressive as a result of the changes over the last 10 or 15 years. I'll just now move to some scenarios. Now, you have a number of these in your media pack, and I won't go through them in detail. I've just got three here. One is an average household, and this is by household, not by individual. A tax cut of about $46 a week, extra GST of 21, better off by about $25 per week. A retired couple, super annuitants, will be better off by about $11 per week. And as we pointed out a couple of months ago, the married rate of national superannuation has since the middle of 2008 moved by about $100 a fortnight. And that is a combined effect of the CPI adjustments and changes in the tax structure, which affect superannuation in a number of different ways. With respect to property investors, the mum and dad property investor do suffer from a bit more taxation with respect to their property investment, but are still a bit better off. If they have two, three, four or more houses, then they will be worse off. So there's a range of New Zealanders here, a very wide range of New Zealanders are going to be better off as a result of the incoming GST switch and the significant base broadening measures. So I just want to recap what we've set out to achieve and what we have achieved in this budget. We wanted to rebalance the tax system for growth. And this system, these changes unambiguously encourage more incentive for work, more into savings and investment, and less encouragement into property and debt. We've provided at the same time tax cuts across the board with the open intention of keeping more skilled Kiwis in New Zealand, but also helping all households get ahead when 73% of all earners face a marginal tax rate of 17.5%. Now that is low by any standard you can think of. The budget also keeps deficits and debt under control and continues with the government's consistent and considered management of its significant fiscal problems, at the same time as channeling more money into our highest priorities. We have also been able, even in these difficult circumstances, to continue with the kind of investment that builds the platform for the future, and that is further investment in science, in tourism, and expanding our resources sector, and very significant investment in infrastructure, which is building up to provide a very large number of jobs, which is important when growth is slow, but more importantly, setting the platform for, we would hope, faster increases in growth in the future. So overall, the budget sets a credible path for growth and builds on the recovery that New Zealanders both need and deserve. I'll now take questions. Because I think it would have simply been symbolism. A lot of people in those higher income levels are not paying the top tax rate, particularly the wealthiest individuals. And we decided we wanted to eliminate the kind of opportunity for restructuring which undermines the integrity of the system. And we believe that by having a straightforward system where those opportunities don't exist, everyone can see it as fair, and everyone is more likely to pay their fair share of tax. That's the first point. And I think the second one is the government's been quite straight up about the need for us to have a competitive environment for skilled people. People who are earning over $70,000 are still paying 33 cents in the dollar, almost twice the tax rate that someone earning under $48,000 is paying. But we need to be competitive with Australia. One of the effects of this package is that where in the past Australians paid less tax than New Zealanders up to about $250,000 of gross income, now they pay less than New Zealanders up to $50,000 of income.
voted is enough to persuade Fitch to remove its payment offer?
Well, in the end, they will decide that. It would be, the credit rating agencies are having a pretty good look at sovereign risk these days, and certainly it's our view that this budget is strong enough for any credit agency to remove a negative watch compared to the other countries they are looking at, and over the next few days we'll have the opportunity to brief them pretty thoroughly on that.
Minister, can you tell us what you think these property tax changes would do to property prices and rents?
We have taken a reasonably fair and balanced approach to the property changes. And we've done that because property still represents the largest single investment for New Zealanders, and we have avoided making very abrupt changes which would be seen as unfair. Where that has happened in the past, those schemes tend to have been unwound under political pressure. What I think is likely to happen is two things. One is the announcement of these measures removes at least the government-generated uncertainty in the property market, and that will help people make their decisions. Treasury's estimates about the impact on rents are pretty mild, that it could increase rents up to about 1.5% over 3 or 4 years. But we will have yet to see how the property market reacts.
To what extent has changes in the debt trap a consequence of policy changes in 2010 as opposed to the economic forecast changes?
Well, we are sticking to the budget allowance that we announced last year. So in that sense, policy changes haven't had a big impact on it. They are mainly changes in forecasts.
Is it possible, Mr. Rivers, that someone who got $20 a week extra in tax charges could see that money eroded by paying greater costs for their retirement education?
Well, we've yet to, with respect to, first point is, consistent with the last budget, despite our large deficits, we have kept all income support in place. There's been no reductions in benefits. There's been significant increases in national super as a result of two rounds of tax cuts. We've left working for families in place with some minor adjustments. Free doctor's visits are all still in place. And the early childhood subsidies are largely still in place. We've yet to see whether there's any flow on to parents. Early childhood centres have done very well in the last 4 or 5 years, because they've had three times as much revenue coming into the system for basically the same number of kids and staff. Three times as much revenue from government. So we've yet to see whether they'll pass on any changes in the subsidies.
You're saying
they don't need to. Well, all I'm saying is we've yet to see. And when you've got a sector that has had a trebling in government revenue, it's quite likely that they've got a bit of freeboard. Who's down here?
Given that New Zealand has already got the second lowest rate of tax on the average earner, did you feel it was really necessary to lower that rate even further so it might actually bottom of the OECD in terms of tax on the average earner as a fair contribution?
Look, our OECD ranking was not our top priority. Our top priority is getting this economy growing as we come out of this recession and lifting our growth rates to meet the kind of ambitions that the government has set for the New Zealand economy. So we decided we wanted to improve those incentives across the board. If we worried about the OECD ranking, we probably would have only cut tax rates at the top. But we don't believe that it's just the incentives for higher earners that matter. We believe the incentives matter right across the income range because New Zealanders want to get ahead. And that's what's critical about our approach to the economy. It's less about carving up the pie, whose slice of cake is bigger than mine, and much more about growing that cake much more about people feeling like they can be mobile up the income range. And when 73% of earners face a marginal tax rate of 17.5%, I think that is a pretty profound signal about the type of country we want to be. And that is where if you get out and get on with your job and save your money, then you get to keep most of it and you get to make your own choices, even if you're on a low income. We are completely confident. The way the adjustments will work is that there will be an adjustment of 2.02% on 1 October, and then the next adjustment will be just 6 months later in April. And if there is a greater rise in prices or a smaller rise in prices, then that will be picked up in the April adjustment. So they can't lose. It's just the way the system works. Well, it does it in a number of ways. First, it changes the incentives for every New Zealander to encourage those things that build growth, which is savings and investment and work and new jobs and exports. And it discourages those things which have held our growth back, consuming too much, borrowing too much, and property speculation. And that applies to every New Zealander. We're not just picking out some of them. Secondly, it continues the investment that we committed to last year in our longer-term infrastructure, and that is quite substantial and ongoing. And thirdly, it focuses on improving the performance of the 25% of the real economy, which is the government. The government is 25% of the cars, buildings, people, IT systems. And that has had very poor performance over the last 6 or 8 years, and we're lifting that, so we're carrying our share of the burden as well.
So how much then of the money that people get taxed, what portion do you expect to be saved and invested to feed that school growth?
We haven't made any prejudgments about that, but the indications are that as a result of the global recession and a widespread understanding among New Zealanders about the risks of debt and overspending, you're seeing quite a shift in what households are doing. They have shut down their borrowing quite significantly. They are increasing their saving. They're paying off debt. And I expect that this tax change is very timely because it's pushing in the direction that people are already going. And in that sense, it is a once-in-a-generation opportunity to change the direction of this economy.
It could be that, obviously. It could also be that 73% of people with $48,000 a year or less, a bit more money to go and spend on something in this super, often important. Fueling inflation, I suspect, increasing interest rates. I just wonder how you see the cause and effect between this kind of increase in spending and a material and meaningful growth. Where is that?
The cause and effect is the choices people make.
Is that an optimistic assumption from you that they're going to make the choice you would have to make? How do you know they're going to do it?
We don't claim we're going to make them take the choices that the economists might say are ideal. What we are saying is we're changing the incentives at the margin, right? This isn't shock treatment for the economy. It's not a government that's going in for hairy-chested, large-scale change. But in our view, the public already have an understanding about what's needed, what they need to do to sustain their own personal position, and what they need to do in their workplace to keep their jobs and improve their incomes. And the tax changes are reinforcing that at the margin. So I would say as a result of this, more people are going to save a bit more because they're going to get a better return from it, less tax on their savings. More people are going to increase their hours when they can, because if you do another hour of work, you get to keep 82 and a half cents, which is not a bad return on an hour's work.
You said that the burden of paying for these tax cuts has been borne by property investors and foreign investors. How big is that burden, and what do you think the relative splits are between property investors paying for it and foreign investors paying for it?
Well, that is all laid out in the numbers, but roughly, and I probably should get Treasury to check them, but the depreciation measures are somewhere around 700 million, about half of what the tax working group estimated. And the thin capitalisation is around a couple of hundred million, I think. But I'd have to check those numbers, they are laid out. 200 or 220? Just over 200 for the thin capitalisation. Well, we never quite anticipated that we'd be putting together this budget in a booming economy. The economic imbalances are so deep-seated that even if we had seen, for instance, the housing market take off from its momentum before Christmas, and people, for some irrational reason, decide that they could go on a spend-up, which are the things that would give you that short-term growth spurt, we would have been wanting to push against them. So I guess the answer is, even if the economy was booming for any reason other than growth in exports, we'd be wanting to bring in this sort of package. We don't want to underestimate the extent to which, in the latter half of the last decade, the economy has got out of balance. The export sector has been shrinking. That tradable sector has shrunk by 10%. The non-tradable sector, driven to a large extent by property speculation and government spending, grew by 15%. So we have to even up the earning and spending capacity of the economy pretty quickly. All those overseas liabilities to foreign lenders, and increasingly grumpy foreign lenders, would make us pretty vulnerable. The government's commitment to the Maori Party is strong and enduring.
Do you see this as part of a series of tax changes over a number of years should be being looked at? Is this a one-off?
The question was, do we see this as part of a series of tax changes? I don't think we would see further changes in the balance of direct and indirect taxation on this scale. And this is something like over 4 years, I think, a $15 billion package. However, I think there may be scope with respect to the way we tax savings and other forms of investment, where further progress could be made, but there would need to be a lot of open discussion about that, of the sort that we've already had over this issue of direct and indirect taxation. But I'd say this is likely to be the biggest change that we'd be making for a while, but it's not the end of tax issues.
What do you say to 1,400
raising GST as a tax reform? Oh, well, I disagree with Honey, and that's not unusual, even for his own party to disagree with him sometimes. The fact is that people on low incomes are at least as well off as they were, and we've made sure that even in a recession, we have protected those who are most vulnerable and most dependent, both in the last budget and this budget. But what they really need is an economy that's going to generate 170,000 new jobs over the next 3 or 4 years. In fact, they need one that's going to generate 250,000 new jobs. So these tax changes are focused on lifting our economic growth rates, and that'll give the people that Honey is concerned about, and we're concerned about, the better sense of opportunity than they have had. Certainly over the last couple of years, when their opportunities have been shrinking rapidly, we must turn that around.
When Labor raised the top rate to 39, one of the main pieces was the break between that and the company rate. Now you've lowered the top rate, but you've also lowered the company rate. still really keeping quite a differential. I mean, is that a problem?
Well, we spent quite a bit. The question was whether the differential between the remaining differential between the company and the top personal rate is still a problem. In our view, quite a bit less of a problem. We've gone into that in some detail, and the official advice has been that that gap of 5% between the company and the personal rate is narrow enough that we don't need to bother with the complexity of further measures to plug the gap. The other advice has been that the single biggest driver of tax avoidance has been the gap between the personal and the trust rate, and we've shut that right down. The measure of that is the data IRD produced for the tax working group, which showed a very substantial increase in trusts since the 39 cent rate came in. There hasn't been a lot to show for that 39 cent rate. It has driven up the value of property losses considerably and was a big factor in driving a housing boom that was, a false sense of wealth. It drove up tax avoidance quite considerably, as illustrated by the big increase in trusts and other structures designed to avoid it.
So what did actually prompt the company tax rate to drop the company tax rate to 28% by 2011?
We were prompted by a couple of things. One is once we could see the ability to do it. The second thing is that we want to get a jump on anyone else as one of the few developed countries that is able to put together this kind of tax package, which shows both to our internal and external investment community that we're open for business and ready to go, and compared to everyone else, we're in great shape. And I think it'll have that effect.
Are you concerned by, I guess, what some business groups are talking about, that banks have not been lending? This is a way to help them invest more?
Yeah, the question is whether we're concerned about the what businesses are saying about banks not being willing to lend. Look, I think the drop in the company tax rate will help lift confidence across the business sector. The other changes we're making to business taxation, though, I'd have to say, are not a lolly scramble. They're losing some on the depreciation side and picking some up on the lower rate across a broader base. With respect to banks lending money, they are responding to some of the rules that have been made by the Reserve Bank. Credit is going to be tighter, as it probably should. It was too loose. So it is important if companies are able to generate more of their own cash, because they're going to need more equity before they do go along to the bank to borrow the rest. So it'll help. Look, we're keen to get out of the blocks early, and we have done that. I would say at the very least we want to make sure that they don't get too far ahead of us. It's a problem for the design of our tax system that company rates tend to be dropping across the board, across the OECD, and certainly across the Asia Pacific area. Even our 30 cent rate has been near the top end. But that's something we'll keep in mind.
Do you think there's ever a good case to increase the thresholds for the personal income tax rates?
Question was whether we think there's ever a good case to increase the thresholds. Look, there's always an argument to do that, particularly if you allow, over time, allow incomes to creep up, go up a long way and don't change the threshold. We just decided to keep this change straightforward and focus on the incentives to get ahead and improving those across the board, rather than chewing up a lot of money on shifting the thresholds.
That's the next question. The
question was whether we'd consider inflation indexing thresholds. The answer is we haven't. It's an open question as to whether you would in the future. I wouldn't necessarily rule it out, but we didn't consider it this time. Yeah, increased from 1.8 to 3.2. you're probably best to get the detailed advice from Treasury, but one thing that has changed since the half-year update has been the shift up in our product prices. So the terms of trade have improved quite significantly across a whole range of our export products, whether it's dairy or logs or meat or fish. Manufacturing has picked up quite a bit because of, mainly driven by the favourable exchange rate with Australia, which is their biggest market. So the good news about that growth forecast is that it is driven by the kind of pickup we would want, which is in our export performance, rather than the general public deciding to go on a spending binge or a housing binge. So the early signs of sustainable growth are promising, and that is why the tax package is so timely, because it's pushing in the direction the economy is starting to move. Again, the question was the forecasts for the years 2 and 3 have been dropped marginally. Again, you're best to talk to the forecasters about the detail of that, but partly it's to do with just getting back to our the way the forecasters work. They're always tending back towards the longer run capacity of the economy. So we get there sooner, they tend to flatten it off a bit more. But they could, you know, there's like a 1% shift down in year 3. You'd be best to talk to them about the detail. Okay, that's about it. Thank you very much.